So today, we're going to talk a little bit about how pain signals are integrated in the brain, but that really is not the primary point of what we're going to talk about today. The primary point of what we're going to talk about today is the negative impact that chronic pain has on the brain. So here, we're going to actually be kind of switching from the kind of basic science investigations we've talked about so far in this class, which is mostly work that's been done in animal models. And by animals, I almost always mean mice or rats. And today, talk about a lot of data that has been gleaned from human functional imaging studies. So we're going to talk about a lot of fMRI studies. So it's kind of funny in the pain field, actually. The peripheral nervous system and the spinal cord, we have a huge amount of information that we've obtained from electrophysiology and molecular genetic studies that have been done in rodents. And a little bit of information about how all this works in humans, but a lot of it has not actually been validated in human DRG neurons, for instance. There's a lot of labs that are currently investing a lot of their resources into doing that. Our lab is one of them. But on the brain side of the story, so after, you know, spinal cord up, while a lot of work has been done on the descending modulatory systems that we talked about the last time we had lecture, whenever that was, last week, right? It was a week ago. There actually is not very much known about how circuitry changes in the brain as pain becomes chronic, and most of what we know is actually from human imaging studies, which is going to be a big portion of what we talk about today. There are a lot of labs throughout the world that are trying to understand this better now, and hopefully when you leave the lecture today, you'll understand why, because we know actually a pretty good deal from the clinical literature about how chronic pain has impacts on lots of other brain functions, from things like cognition to depression, anxiety, etc. But we don't really have a very good idea of how it actually happens. So, you know, that's why people use animal models, to understand the intricate details, and then to utilize that information to try to improve disease outcomes, be it through therapeutics or whatever else you might be able to do to intervene. Okay? So that's what we're going to primarily talk about today. So this is just to remind you of some of the things that we already talked about, but also to again highlight this key feature of the pain system that doesn't happen for most of the other sensory systems, and that is that this particular system distributes very widely throughout the brain. So here's the ascending part coming up from the spinal dorsal horn again, going into the PAG and the parabrachial nucleus and into the thalamus. This shows you actually how these parabrachial nuclei projections can bypass the thalamus altogether and go straight into the limbic system, into the amygdala, and then the amygdala can connect into the prefrontal cortex. And then from the thalamus, you have inputs into the insula, the anterior cingulate cortex, primary somatosensory cortex, and other areas. Primary somatosensory cortex is the where part of this, right? It tells you where the pain is coming from. But the emotional and other components of pain are mostly occurring because of these projections that go all throughout the brain, okay? So what we're going to try to talk about today is the existing mostly human neuroimaging literature that shows how these areas of the brain are changed with chronic pain, and then we're going to tie in at the end a little bit of what we know about how this works in the circuit detail, mostly from animal experiments, and how we're trying to use that information to better understand how pain becomes chronic, number one, and also how to make better pain medications. Okay, so one of the first studies that was done of the type that we're going to focus on today was done at Northwestern University by a very well-known, originally neurophysiologist, but then became human brain imager named Vanya Karin. So he had a very simple but kind of revolutionary idea for the field. And that idea, I think, stemmed from the very rich clinical literature that has demonstrated for many decades now that in people that have chronic pain, especially severe chronic pain, that they have all kinds of other comorbidities that often lead to disability. In fact, for people that have what we call high-impact chronic pain, so this is a relatively small portion of the population, but about 10% of people that have high-impact chronic pain happens mostly later in life. It's often of a neuropathic origin. Most of those people are disabled, okay? They're unable to go about their normal daily functions, and they're mostly not able to work. And it's not always the pain that makes them disabled. It's the other comorbidities that come with pain. So that includes things like cognitive dysfunction, depression, anxiety, and there are many pain diseases that we now recognize as chronic pain disorders that were referred to previously as hysterias, because many physicians, frankly, before they understood how the pain system worked, did not believe these people. So, as you guys hopefully have already recognized, you know, neuroplasticity is not something that we have a standard laboratory test for, right? If you go, you know, you have chronic low back pain, and you have an MRI, and there's no evidence of anything wrong in your spine, and you see somebody that knows nothing about the nervous system, which hopefully doesn't happen anymore, but, you know, think back to 20 or 30 years ago when we knew very little about these types of systems, and that person may conclude that there's nothing wrong with this person, and in fact, it's all in their brain, and they have a hysteria, or they're crazy, right? And these other comorbidities that come along with pain may actually drive that person even more strongly to think that, right? The person may say, I have a great deal of difficulty concentrating. I can't do just normal arithmetic without a great deal of effort because I just can't concentrate. I can't keep track of anything in my short-term memory. The idea of bending over to pick something up off of the floor terrifies me because it could make my back, you know, go crazy. But they may not say that. They may just say, you know, I'm scared to move and I'm depressed. And that could lead the person to conclude, hey, you know, this person's nuts. There's nothing wrong with them. They're just crazy. So I don't know that this was actually Van Nieuwkerken's motivation to do these studies, but I think it's something that was kind of widely appreciated in the field, especially among people that were interested in chronic pain and neuroplasticity, was that it's difficult to explain all these comorbidities that come along with pain unless you start thinking about how pain impacts the brain a little bit differently. Okay, so we've been talking about over and over and over again in this course that the neuroanatomy of the pain system is such that it goes to primary somatosensory cortex like all the other senses do, but also distributes through lots of other parts of the brain, and you have a consistent input from that that presumably is driving changes in neural circuits and may actually cause bigger pathological changes than that, okay? So functional MRI is a technique that gives you insight into what looks like, what the brain of a living person looks like, right? So the things that functional MRI cannot do is record action potentials and tell you, you know, neuron X is firing in this area of the brain and that's causing neuron Y to fire in this area of the brain, right? Functional magnetic resonance imaging, which is what fMRI stands for, is capable of looking at basically a metabolism in the brain, right, in real time. So what it's typically doing is looking at what we call the bulb signal, okay? And basically that's a measure of oxygenation of different areas of the brain, and the limitation of how fine you can see these details is basically how strong the magnet is, okay? So magnets that were used back when Van Nieuwkerken was doing these original studies are not as good as they are now, and they're getting better, continuously better and better. If any of you guys have ever been to the Center for Brain Health or Center for Vital Longevity on this campus, you know, where people do lots of functional brain imaging, they go down to UT Southwestern's magnets, which are right next to them, and they have some amazing facilities there that are brand new, and they have state-of-the-art magnets that can get you really fine resolution, but still not down to the level of single neurons. And in fact, fact, we'll never get there because that's not what it's actually measuring, right? It's measuring changes in oxygenation, which is linked to metabolism. So what happens is that astrocytes, which are able to monitor neuronal activity, they change blood flow, right? Because if you guys remember from your basic neurobiology course, astrocytes have these infeet on them that are sitting on all the capillary beds in the brain that control the amount of oxygen, basically, right? Because they're controlling the amount of blood flow through the capillaries. And they're coupled to neuronal activity, right? So it gives you a indicator of neuronal activity, but it doesn't necessarily mean that a neuron is firing here and another neuron is firing there. The other thing that functional MRI can do very nicely is give you a standard MRI image. And a standard MRI image, if you do the scan long enough, can give you really beautiful information about the structure of somebody's brain, okay? So that's actually what these original studies were all about. So the hypothesis that was being tested here was that chronic pain clinically often manifests as a set of comorbidities that look very similar to what happens in neurodegenerative disorders. Okay? So does it anatomically look like a neurodevelopmental disorder? So that was the kind of revolutionary question that Ekkarian's lab asked, and this is one of the very first papers that was published on that idea. So what did they do? They recruited a bunch of people to the hospital at Northwestern University in Chicago to do imaging. And they stratified them by normal controls, so healthy people that don't have pain that were age matched to the clinical sample. And then they had people that had non-neuropathic chronic back pain. So these are people that have pain in their back, but it doesn't radiate down the legs, okay? So we still classify this as non-neuropathic, even though that may not actually be appropriate, but there's no indication that they have a radiating nerve injury, okay? And then they also took people that had what we call radiculopathy. So that means they have pain that's shooting down their legs. That's a cardinal sign of impingement on some other anatomical problem with the nerves that are innervating the legs, okay? So even though it feels like it's radiating down the legs, the problem is not actually in the legs. The problem is where the nerve roots are coming out. And sometimes these people have had a disc herniation or something like that. Sometimes they don't have any visible pathology, okay? So many people don't have any visible pathology and still have what we call radiculopathy, okay? But they stratified them because this has a clear neuropathic component, okay? You don't get radiating pain unless there's some activity on those nerves. And then what they did was just simply to do a scan with the MRI to look at cortical thickness, okay? So again, consistent with the idea that there might be some kind of neurodegeneration. And what they found was quite surprising. That is that they saw decreased gray matter density, okay? So the cortical thickness was decreased, and it was decreased even more in the people that had signs of neuropathic pain, okay? So essentially what this did back in 2004 when it was first published was set off a whole bunch of different studies that were done in a whole bunch of different labs, okay? So I'm gonna show you a couple of the other ones. So this is for chronic low back pain, and this is just showing you some more data from the same paper, okay? So it actually looks like it gets worse with age, and it gets worse with duration of pain, okay? So pain intensity increases the magnitude of the gray matter loss, and the duration of pain that people have had also increases the gray matter loss. So a couple of questions stem from this, all right? So one of them is, how generalizable is this? Is this only something that happens in people that have chronic low back pain, or could you see it in many other chronic pain disorders? And number two, it looks like neurodegeneration, the symptoms look like neurodegeneration, but do these people actually have neurodegeneration, right? So there's two hypothesis that you could come up with. One of them is that there's a reversible process occurring that's reflective of some neuronal plasticity, that if you were able to effectively take a cohort of patients where you saw they had decreased gray matter density and then treat their pain effectively, you might be able to show that it's restored, right? So the alternative is that there may be real neurodegeneration and these people are basically screwed, right? So even if you make the pain go away, the comorbidities that come along with it, like the cognitive decline, could be irreversible. So has anybody ever heard of pain patients basically like turning into Alzheimer's patients or something like that? No, right? So I think the hypothesis would be that this should be a reversible process that just looks like neurodegeneration, but it's not actually neurodegeneration, okay? All right, so let's go through the next slides, which will get to both of those questions. All right, so first, there have been a number of different studies done at this point, basically in any chronic pain disorder you can think of, that shows essentially the same thing, right? Cortical thinning, it's not always the same brain areas, but cortical thinning, especially in areas of the brain that are involved in pain processing and pain modulation, so things like the anterior cingulate cortex, the insula, that receive lots of inputs from the pain system, these show cortical thinning in people that have chronic pain, right? So this is an example, for instance, of trigeminal neuralgia. So this is neuropathic pain in the face and head region. Same thing in fibromyalgia. So there's cortical thinning, in this case, mostly in the hippocampus, the cingulate gyrus, insula, and the prefrontal cortex, specifically the medial prefrontal cortex. So that's the area of the brain that's mostly involved in cognition and attention. Yes?
What's fibromyalgia?
So fibromyalgia, yeah, we haven't done the actual chronic pain types, right? So we'll get into more detail on all of these in the fourth part of the course, but fibromyalgia is a widespread pain disease that is not very well understood, but it's typically associated with what are called tender points, and it's often referred to as a chronic muscle pain disease. So it was originally thought that this was a central nervous system disorder, but as we'll talk about in the fourth part of the course, just in the last 5 years, actually, there's a lot of evidence that people with fibromyalgia have a small fiber neuropathy. Nobody knows, and a small fiber neuropathy is just a neuropathy of C fibers, basically, okay? Because they're, remember, those are the small diameter ones. So I can't tell you why people with fibromyalgia look like they have a small fiber neuropathy, but there's a lot of evidence that, that there is a small fiber neuropathy associated with fibromyalgia. Okay?
Is it genetic sort of thing? Is fibromyalgia?
There's not, so I don't know that literature as well as like migraine or some other chronic pain disorders like that that tend to happen in younger people. Migraine, there certainly is a strong genetic component. Fibromyalgia, I really don't know. I would imagine yes, but I don't know. Yes?
So I was just curious, since you talked a little bit about it, how is that different than a somatization disorder? And are they still like legit clinical diagnoses of those?
So, fibromyalgia, so most of you guys have probably heard of fibromyalgia, right? So fibromyalgia primarily affects women, and actually not so terribly long ago was called female hysteria. That was the name that was used for it. So if you ask me why this is used, it's just BS. It's just a cluster of symptoms that people were not able to explain because you don't have diagnostic tools to actually demonstrate that there's something wrong, right? So if fibromyalgia is an interesting disease to talk about because it has a long history of being classified in very negative ways against a particular part of the population that happens to be 50% of the population. So it was initially often called female hysteria. You can go look in the literature, it's there, and this wasn't too terribly long ago. Embarrassingly short period of time ago that it was called that. Eventually became classified as fibromyalgia more widely, but people still largely had no explanation for it. And you can talk to certain people and they'll tell you fibromyalgia is just crazy people, maybe using more colorful and negative language. But if you look at the very recent literature done by, you know, scientists that are actually trying to understand what's going on, the case for a small fiber neuropathy being the underlying cause of fibromyalgia is very strong. The issue is that up until we had better diagnostic tools, it was extraordinarily difficult, if not impossible, to try to do that kind of assessment. So I think, you know, for you, for a class like this, where almost everybody wants to go on to some kind of clinical career, I think it's really important to recognize that an absence of some type of evidence doesn't mean that there's no evidence, right? We're all, as you know, as a clinician, as a scientist, we're all completely dependent on the tools that we have to interrogate a question in terms of whether or not we can find a meaningful answer. So the tools that we have to look at the nervous system are still very primitive, right? If you want to do a relatively invasive procedure to look at cardiac function, there's a lot of stuff you can do, right? And you can measure just about anything you want. You have fairly good access to it, right? If you have an idea about a psychiatric disorder and want to measure something from a subset of patients, the answer to that, in terms of like biopsying the brain or something like that, is going to be what? Flat out no, right? In almost every case. The exception maybe is epilepsy, where people still have resections of epileptic foci in their brain, and you can take that out and do electrophysiology and try to get a better understanding of what's actually happening in the disease process on a cellular level. I got on my soapbox a little bit. Did I answer the question? Okay, good. All right. So this is basically showing you that there is changes in the brain that occur with fibromyalgia. Trigeminal neuralgia was the previous slide, same story. And if you go and do this in animal models, this was actually done by a guy I'm very good friends with, Dave Siminowicz. He was a postdoc at McGill, starting about the same time that I left. He's now at University of Maryland. He did a very neat study where they took rats in this case. So they had at McGill they had, so a lot of these studies were also done at McGill, not the first one from Van Yarkarian's lab, that was at Northwestern, but this one that they were doing MRI imaging in rats, okay, so longitudinal imaging in rats with neuropathic pain. And what he observed, so the sham group is a surgery where he exposes the nerve but doesn't actually do an injury, and the SNI group, SNI stands for spared nerve injury, it's just a type of neuropathic pain model that's frequently used. And what he saw was that in basically the same regions where you see cortical thinning in human beings with neuropathic pain, if you take a rat and induce neuropathic pain, that you see cortical thinning in the same areas. Okay, and the primary places where he saw that was in the medial prefrontal cortex, which again is involved in cognition, mostly attention. Okay, and we'll come back to that in a lot of detail in the next couple of slides, and in the insula. Okay, so very important. Pain processing areas, and also areas that have a big impact on just normal everyday function. Okay, so the first question was, does this happen across pain models? And you could even ask, does it happen in preclinical models? And the answer is yes. So if you look at basically any chronic pain disorder you can think of in human beings, you can see these kind of phenotypes happening in the brain. And if you take a rodent model of neuropathic pain, you see basically just what's happening in human beings also happening in the brain of the rats, okay? So the next question, which has been answered by two different groups, first Van Yarkarian's group again, and then another really nice study that was done by Dave, actually. Both of them have studied low back pain patients because you see this very robust decrease in cortical thickness in these people. They've done now two very, very nice, very elegant clinical studies where they took a cohort of patients and gave them a specific treatment and determined the people it was effective in, the people it was not effective in, and then they looked at whether it reversed the cortical thinning, all right? So this is going to the question of whether or not this cortical thinning is actually inducing neurodegeneration, which is not reversible, right? Or if this is a reversible process that must be related to some plasticity mechanism that we probably don't understand, okay? And what was seen in this study is that they took patients that responded to a lidocaine patch, okay? So this is basically a local anesthetic. They put it on their low back, and patients that responded and patients that did not respond were stratified, and then they did imaging to see whether it reversed the cortical thinning after 2 weeks of treatment, okay? And what they saw was that it very robustly reversed the pathology, okay? So it doesn't seem to be neurodegeneration. Why the actual shape of the cortex can change so rapidly in the negative direction and then be improved over a 2 week time course is still a big mystery. So I don't think anybody has a good answer for why the cortical thinning happens in the first place, but it's not because neurons are dying. It presumably is not because you're getting a major loss of synaptic connections. It may be all about a glial response. I really don't know. But it is clearly reversible, okay? So this trial showed it was reversible, and then another trial that was done subsequently, in fact, quite larger trial by Dave Siminowicz, whose data from rats I showed you right here, showed the same thing, right? So it is reversible, so there's hope, right? The problem is that most of the treatments that we have for these chronic pain disorders don't work very well, right? So all these comorbidities that come about could presumably be treated simply by reversing the pain, but it's very hard to reverse the pain. We need better therapeutics to make that happen. Okay, so one of the key hubs for the connection to all of these areas of the brain that we've been talking about where you see cortical thinning is the amygdala, okay? So that's kind of the common factor that they have. These are all cortical areas that are connected very robustly to the limbic center, the limbic centers, and in particular to the amygdala. And in the amygdala, there's an area of the amygdala called the central nucleus of the amygdala that receives an extraordinarily strong input from the pain system, and also shows really dramatic plasticity if you induce a chronic pain model in rodents. All right. So the CEA, those of us in the pain field often refer to this actually as the nociceptive amygdala. All right. So I'm going to show you some experiments now from Volker Neugebauer's lab. So this guy is at Texas Tech Medical School. He's the chair of pharmacology out there. So if anybody's interested in going to tech for medical school, there's a decent chance that you would talk to Volker. He's also an MD PhD, so he's very involved in the interviewing process there. So if anybody interested in going to tech? Okay, a couple. You all raising your hands reluctantly. You didn't record that part, did you? I don't blame you. All right, so. I'm a UT guy. All right, so. This is showing you now what you would consider a kind of classic experiment from Volker's lab. So basically what he did is he took rats and induced arthritis and looked at what we call the receptive field of those neurons. Okay, so first of all, what is a receptive field? So if you're recording from a neuron that receives pain input, okay, nociceptive input, the receptive field is the area of the body that it will respond to. Okay. So if you were looking, for instance, at a lumbar dorsal horn neuron that innervates the paw of a rat, more than likely the receptive field for that neuron is going to be the paw of the rat, right? Not the head of the rat. So the amygdala is a little bit different because these are, at this point, going to be at least second, maybe third order neurons, so there could be convergence of the anatomical pathway. But under normal conditions, it does seem that in both the left and the right amygdala, central nucleus of the amygdala, that if you record from an individual neuron, it has a defined receptive field. Okay. But what's very interesting is if you give the animal arthritis, okay, that changes the receptive field quite dramatically, but it does it only on one side. Right. So the left amygdala after arthritis there's no change. But in the animals on the right side, basically the receptive field of the neuron changes from a defined part of the body to the entire body, okay? So there's a very dramatic plasticity. And why this happens only on the right side is not very well known, but in all animals where this has been studied in any detail so far, the right central nucleus of the amygdala is the nociceptive amygdala. The left side doesn't really show any plasticity, and the right side shows very robust plasticity. Okay, so I don't know that this would also be seen in humans, but you know, most of this usually carries over pretty well, so I would imagine so. So the idea behind why this is so important is because the CDA sends a big projection to the prefrontal cortex, okay? And that, again, is the place where a lot of your executive function happens, including lots of cognitive function and cognitive function that requires attention. And that, again, is what we'll go through in a lot of detail in the next couple slides, is what many chronic pain patients really complain a lot about. All right, so there are many comorbidities of chronic pain. One of the best known ones is depression. I'm not going to spend a lot of time on this, but this has been observed in trial after trial after trial. And what seems to occur is that the longer people have chronic pain and the more intense the pain is, the higher the incidence of depression goes up. Okay. So I'm not actually going to talk about these in any detail, but I want to get to this part, so the cognitive impairment part. So we think that one of the reasons that this happens is because of all these inputs into the PFC from these areas of the prefrontal cortex, from areas of the brain that receive lots of nociceptive inputs and also show really dramatic plasticity in chronic pain. And these cognitive impairments, if you look at chronic pain patients, affect most of them, and along with depression is a major cause of disability. Okay, so if you just think about, you know, trying to have chronic pain and to work, if you have a lot of trouble paying attention to what you're doing and making decisions, etc., it's very challenging to work, right? It'd be challenging to sit in a classroom, probably. So this is thought to be, along with depression, to be a major cause of the reason that people become disabled when they have chronic pain. So what is the evidence, first of all, that chronic pain patients have problems with this? So again, we're going to go back to some work that was done by Vanya Karian's lab. So first of all, I'm going to introduce some experimental tasks that are used to assess cognition in humans. And there's a couple different ones. One is this attentional interference task. So this is a test where basically you're asking somebody, you hold up a card, okay? So first of all, I hold up this card, what number comes to mind? Six. What other number comes to mind?
Four.
Four. All right, so you can probably figure out what the task is, right? So you ask people to either give you the value, right? So the value here would be four. I guess you could also say 24, right? But it'd be four because there's four numbers here. Or to give the number that's shown, six, right? So how about this one?
One
or nine, right? All right. So this is a game that requires attention. And it requires attention because what you do is you switch the game on people, right? So you hold up a card and you're telling them, you tell me the number that's on the card. So you show them the six, show them the one, and then after some period of time you say, tell me the value, and you hold up the cards. It takes all of us some time to change our strategy, okay? And so you basically are just timing the response. But and this was shown a long time ago. If you look at people that have high pain, they're unable to do this task. So when you switch, their response rate more than doubles, right? So this is a very well-known task that relies on prefrontal cortex function in humans and demonstrates that with pain, there is dysfunction in the prefrontal cortex. Okay? So that's one type of task. Another is what we call the Iowa gambling task. This is way more commonly used. Some of you guys may have heard of this one before, actually. So the way that this works is that you have decks of cards, right? And what you have to do is to figure out which deck of cards is going to give you the best return on picking the card, right? So let's take, for instance, deck A here. So the first card you get $90, right? So you're feeling good, doing okay. The next one, you can either get plus 25 or minus 75, depending on what you take, all right? So you're starting to become a little bit more negative. Now you got plus 25 or minus 50, and then you got minus 50. So if you sum up what you could potentially get from this deck, you can get 140 on the positive side, or you can get minus 175 on the negative side. So would you classify this as a good or a bad deck?
Bad.
It's a bad deck, right? You should not be choosing cards from this deck, right? So what you want to do is to find a deck where you're going to be on the plus side, all right? So essentially, what the game is to find cards that are in these decks that are going to give you a slow and steady reward, but no negatives, all right? And you play the game, you're basically playing against a computer, but you're trying to maximize your gains, right? So you're trying to win the game by getting to a certain value. So what happens is that at some point when you're playing this game, the decks get shuffled, and you have to relearn the strategy by finding the right cards, okay? And if you take any of us in this room, presumably we don't have a prefrontal cortex lesion, or we're not a chronic pain patient, and we are able to switch our strategy pretty well. So in this case, the good decks are the C and D decks, the bad decks are the A and B decks, and then they get switched at some point, but you still classify the C and D as the good decks. And normals will do fairly well. This is, again, an experiment from Vega Karian's lab. But what they did here was to test chronic back pain patients and complex regional pain syndrome patients. So I know we haven't talked about complex regional pain syndrome yet, but it's an absolutely horrific chronic pain disorder that's basically a mix of inflammatory and neuropathic pain. And you see that neither of these people do particularly well. The complex regional pain syndrome patients who have very intense pain basically all the time do particularly poorly, right? So these two types of tasks demonstrate that there's prefrontal cortex dysfunction in people that have chronic pain that impacts their ability to perform well on these cognitive tasks. There's many other examples of this. The only reason I bring this one up, and I'm not actually going to go into any detail about it, is that this particular task, which was done in a set of chronic neuropathic pain patients, they actually took people and gave them the gold standard medication for neuropathic pain and tested whether their prefrontal cortex function improved with pain treatment. And in this particular experiment, they found that there was no improvement, right? So there may even be some indications that even though cortical thickness can be improved by treatment, that treatment is not always able to reverse some of the problems that may occur in some of these brain regions. The unfortunate thing about this is we don't really have a very good idea at all about what's going wrong in the prefrontal cortex in people that have chronic pain. Okay? So this is another good example, though, of experimental paradigm that has now been translated back into rodents. So this is a series of experiments that were again done by Volker Neugebauer's lab. And basically what they did was to develop a Iowa gambling task for rats. So for rats, rats don't care about money, but they do care about food. So they basically set up the same thing I'm just telling you, but did it with levers and food reward, okay? So they tested whether the rats could figure out which levers would give them the best food reward. And the normal rats were actually quite good at this task, but the rats with persistent arthritis were not able to do it, okay? So this particular task is also well known to involve the prefrontal cortex in rodents, so it's very consistent with what we see in humans with chronic pain. All right, so to conclude at least from this part, We know that chronic pain adversely affects the brain. It does this in at least a couple of ways. One is it decreases cortical gray matter, which we don't know exactly what that is, but you see these decreases in cortical gray matter in areas of the brain that are associated with the comorbidities that people get with chronic pain, so presumably it could be playing some role in that. But unfortunately, we don't really understand very well the molecular mechanisms that drive this. But the good news is that at least in some set of chronic pain disorders, if you treat the pain effectively, you can reverse these changes that are seen in the brain. Okay? So it's also true that chronic pain often shows significant comorbidity with many psychiatric disorders, the primary one being depression. And again, remember, antidepressants are frequently used to treat comorbidities. But remember again that the way that we think that these work is through increasing norepinephrine in the spinal cord. So it's tough to determine, you know, if you treat somebody with an SNRI and the pain goes away and the depression goes away, which came first. But you might hypothesize that it's actually relieving the pain that also fixes the other problems. Then again, you might not hypothesize that. I don't know anybody knows what the answer is. All right, so I want to just close by showing you guys a couple things that we're doing in our lab, because I think that they're very exciting, related to this. All right, so I showed you a little bit of data from Volker Neubauer's lab, where they're showing this rat gambling task, right? But that task is really hard to teach animals to do. It's very, very time consuming. And it's hard to make drug manipulations when you have these very long training sessions. Okay, so basically what we did is we decided to adapt a different testing strategy that's used in Sven Kroner's lab. So have you guys had a class? People had a class with Sven Kroner? Almost everybody's nodding their head. All right, good. So Dr. Kroner is a professor here. He does mostly addiction and schizophrenia research, right? So schizophrenia, if you guys know anything about that disease, is mostly thought of as a disease of the prefrontal cortex, right? So we don't know exactly how the frontal cortex goes awry, but Sven's lab works on lots of different hypotheses related to schizophrenia and the PFC, and has a very robust task that assesses attentional set shifting in mice. That we decided to test with neuropathic pain. So, as I've told you guys many times, the kind of classic testing for neuropathic pain is simply assessing withdrawal thresholds, right? And most people that have chronic pain have mechanical or thermal hypersensitivity, but it's very rare that people with chronic pain ever go to a physician and say, you know, I have thermal hypersensitivity and I really want it to go away. They go to physicians and say, I'm in pain all the time, I can't think, I don't want to get out of bed, this is affecting every aspect of my life, and I want the pain to go away, right? So we wanted to try to see if we could find a way to assess robustly some of these comorbidities, like prefrontal cortex dysfunction, and to see if we can manipulate it therapeutically. So we use this attentional set shifting task. I don't want to go through all the details, but basically what it is we teach the animals to go after a Cheerio. So mice love Cheerios, and you can teach them very easily to do this. You give them a strategy for where the Cheerio is, and then it's like the gambling task or the other tasks we talked about. You switch the strategy on them, and you figure out how long it takes them to switch their attention to go and find the Cheerio again. Okay? So that's what we do. We test whether these animals show deficits. So we use the spare nerve injury, which I talked about before. It's a standard neuropathic pain model. And what does the data look like? Well, this is the important part. So we have a couple different groups here. We have a sham group. I don't know why the colors show up completely differently here than here, but anyway. This is the control group, okay? This is the animals that have neuropathic pain. And then we have two treatments. We have treatment with clonidine, which is an acute analgesic, just one injection. And we also have treatment with metformin, which is something that my lab has actually worked on a long time, and we think is a disease, potentially disease-modifying therapy for neuropathic pain. Okay, so this is similar to the experiments that have been done in humans, where they give people a treatment that makes the pain go away, and then test whether the sequelae of having chronic pain also go away, right? All right, so first of all, you can see that the magnitude of the effect on the set shifting is massive, right? So animals that have neuropathic pain really perform very, very poorly in this task. They're not able to figure out that we move their cheerio and figure out where their cheerio has gone, right? It takes them a long time to figure that out. So there's a clear prefrontal cortex dysfunction. The other thing that is very interesting about this, which is consistent, if you remember with the slide with all the elevators, I told you that taking a neuropathic pain patients and giving them a standard analgesic doesn't seem to actually improve their cognitive function. If we give them an acute analgesic, which is clonidine, so clonidine is an alpha-2 adrenergic receptor agonist. So hopefully for this part of the course, you guys already know what that is because you've got an exam coming up in a couple days. So alpha-2 adrenergic receptors are receptors for norepinephrine. They're found in the spinal cord. They're the inhibitory ones. So when you activate them, they lead to presynaptic inhibition on nociceptors, and they cut off the signal as it enters the spinal cord. So we give clonidine intrathecally basically to mimic a strong activation of descending inhibition, and then test the animals whether, number one, they have analgesia, and number two, whether they have a reversal of their cognitive impairment. So I'm not showing you the analgesia data, but they do have analgesia. The pain is gone, right? But the cognitive impairment is not. It's just as robust as it was before. So metformin acts differently. Metformin seems to repair the pathology in the peripheral nervous system. I can't tell you that metformin is going to work in humans. The dose that we give in the mice is way, way higher than what a human would take for metformin. It may not be possible to get the dose high enough in humans. However, we can at least demonstrate that a disease-modifying therapeutic can reverse this pathology. Right? So you may have reached the conclusion from the elevator slide that while the cortical thinning can go away, the cognitive dysfunction won't be repaired by an analgesic. But that doesn't seem to be the case. Not an analgesic, but disease-modifying therapy. The disease-modifying therapy can reverse the cognitive impairment. So now what we're trying to do, and this is a big collaborative effort between our lab and Sven's lab, is to figure out what the molecular mechanisms are that cause this, but also to understand what molecular mechanisms cause this to occur. And that is what one of the things that's on these slides here. So these are some beautiful images of the prefrontal cortex. I don't know if these are from sham or spared nerve injury animals, but basically what we found now was a very specific molecular pathology in the prefrontal cortex of the animals with neuropathic pain. It's kind of surprising what it is. It's actually that these axon initial segments, so the very first part of the axon that comes off of the cell body, where there's a concentration of the voltage-gated sodium channels, in particular NAD1.6, that gets much shorter in the animals that have neuropathic pain. So we don't understand exactly why it happens, but a shortening of the axon initial segment means that the neurons are less excitable because they're less able to integrate depolarizations into generation of an action potential. Because remember, if you guys have taken cellular neuroscience, the way that cells integrate their inputs into an output is by integrating all the depolarization that happens in the dendrites and the stroma at the axon hillock. And if that's big enough to generate an action potential, it then sends the output, right? And that critically depends on the concentration of NAV1.6 that you have at the axon initial segment. If there's no more NAV1.6 there, the cell is more excitable. If there's less NAV1.6 there, the cell is less excitable. So basically what we think is happening is that the for reasons that we don't know, but what seems to be happening is that the kind of input-output function of the pyramidal neurons in the PFC is disrupted in chronic pain. So they're less able, presumably, to send a signal out from the same amount of input that they receive, okay, because it makes them less excitable. All right, so I think that's the last slide. Last slide of this section of the course. So number one, if there's any questions from today, you can answer them. And number two, if you guys have questions about any of the other lectures for the last exam, can sense of those now too. We have, oh, my Fitbit's dead. What's time we have? Okay.
I was wondering with regards to the slides you asked about asset MRIs and like how they contribute to pain relief.
Mm-hmm.
You mentioned how serotonin affects facilitation of pain and can actually contribute to like the increased pain.
Mm-hmm.
So since SNRI stands for, if I remember correctly, serotonin and norepinephrine reuptake inhibitor, why does the serotonin increase not impact pain relief?
All right, did everybody hear that question? The question was, SNRIs, serotonin norepinephrine reuptake inhibitors, are used for neuropathic and other types of chronic pain. They are thought to be effective because they increase norepinephrine levels in the spinal cord. But there's an S there, and actually there's two S's, but the first S is the one that matters. And that one is serotonin. They also block serotonin. And I told you guys that descending facilitation seems to primarily be mediated by serotonin. So do these drugs also potentially enhance pain, or is there some disbalance there because they're also increasing serotonin? Could they work better if they just block norepinephrine? So first of all, that is an absolutely fantastic question. You clearly understand what you need to understand if you're ready for the exam. So congratulations. Second of all, I mean, I've asked that question to myself over and over and over again. And I mean, theoretically, yeah, that's totally the problem. I don't know that anybody has ever made a specific norepinephrine reuptake inhibitor and tried to move it towards the clinic, but if such a thing existed and I could get my hands on it, I would totally be doing experiments with it because I think it should be much better. I mean, based on all of the neurophysiological evidence that we have, SNRIs, which are, so the type of drugs that are available to use clinically right now are either pretty selective for serotonin and mostly not used for treating chronic pain, or they block both serotonin and norepinephrine. And presumably could be much better if you got rid of the first S, right? But I've never seen a drug that does that. The thing that's really interesting that's not appreciated very much about these transporters is that the norepinephrine transporter, the serotonin transporter, and the dopamine transporter, for that matter, are all very specifically expressed by their individual types of neurons, right? Serotonin neurons express the SERT. Norepinephrine neurons express the NET. But if you expose the NET to serotonin, it takes it up just fine. If you expose the NET the SERT to norepinephrine, it takes it up just fine. So the specificity that they have is brought about by their expression. It's not because they're actually specific for the molecules. And in terms of pharmacological design, that makes it very difficult because what it means is that they're actually quite promiscuous, right? They can recognize a number of different molecules. So what you would want to do is actually a very hard problem because the pharmacophore is very similar between all of them. So making a molecule that will be very specific for the NET is very hard. It's obviously been accomplished for the SERT, right? So it can be done, but to my knowledge, nobody has really done it. And if somebody knows that it's out there, please send it to me because I would like to study those molecules. But theoretically, yeah, you're absolutely right. They should be much better. Yeah.
So how does metformin like reverse the?
All right. So the question is, how does metformin work? So you totally don't need to know this for your exam. However, it's a fun story. So how many of you guys have heard of metformin? First of all, yeah, so a lot of you. So what was metformin used for? Yes, diabetes. So metformin is the most widely prescribed drug in the world. It's used for type 2 diabetes. And while its mechanism of action is not perfectly understood, it activates a signaling pathway called AMP-activated protein kinase, or AMPK. So in metabolism, this is good because it lowers glucose, okay? But in the nervous system, AMPK is a negative regulator of signaling pathways that promote excitability. So we had this idea a long time ago that the pathways that we were studying could be inhibited by activating AMP-kinase. And we decided to work with two primary molecules, metformin and resveratrol. So I'm not going to tell the resveratrol story again because I already told it in here. But metformin could potentially be a fantastic drug for neuropathic pain because it's safe. There's hundreds of millions of people in the world taking metformin. And if you go to the poison control data to see how many times they have toxicities for metformin, I mean, it's close to zero. So it's a very safe drug. The issue with it is that it's almost impossible to know in humans if the dose that people are given, which at most people it's about 1 gram a day, a small portion of people it's 2 grams a day, whether that actually activates AMP kinase, because it takes a lot of the drug to activate AMP kinase. The drugs that we give to rodents are 200 mg per kg, and if you do the conversion, given that metabolism is different between rodents, and by metabolism, I mean drug metabolism is different between rodents and humans, we're still giving at least 10 times the dose to rodents that's given to humans, probably closer to 20 times the dose. And the plasma concentrations that are seen in rodents with that dose are nowhere near what you get in humans for 2 grams per day for metformin. So I feel pretty confident that the way that metformin works and the data I showed you there is by activating AMP kinase in the peripheral nervous system, which repairs the augmented activity of the nociceptors, which we're actually going to talk about that in a lot of detail in the third part of the course. But the question is whether or not you could actually use metformin in humans to treat chronic pain, and the answer to that is a big fat I don't know, because there's a big problem in trying to increase the dose to a sufficient level. So what we're trying to do is two things. One is to do a prospective clinical trial to demonstrate that metformin can be effective in people that have non-diabetic neuropathic pain. So that trial is actually, I think, getting dangerously close to starting at McGill University. So we're going to do it with some people that I know up there. We're going to do it for people that have chemotherapy neuropathy. And we're going to look for prevention of chemotherapy neuropathy. The other issue is if that trial is negative and you can't ever take the metformin dose high enough, can you still manipulate AMP kinase to alleviate neuropathic pain? And to try to do that, we're trying to make very potent activators of AMP kinase, because if we were to discover such molecules, we could presumably test whether or not they would, number one, be safe, and number two, whether or not they could work on neuropathic pain in humans. And the good news there is that Merck, which is one of the world's biggest pharmaceutical companies, published a beautiful paper a couple months ago, actually, demonstrating that they found a very, very potent AMP kinase activator, and they dosed rhesus monkeys with it for 6 months, and it was very safe. So that suggests it would also be very safe in human beings. It's also very safe in rodents, but it's not always true that if a drug is safe in rodents, it'll also be safe in humans, but it's very rare that it's safe in another primate species and not safe in rodents. There may be side effects. Cognitive side effects are something that were difficult to assess in that study, but I think it's very promising. To answer the question?
Does it have anything, does that also affect NAD 1.6 in any way?
So it looks like if you activate AMP kinase, you decrease the activity of mini-multiplicative sodium channels, but we've never looked specifically at NAV 1.6. NAV 1.7 and 1.8 we have done, and it works for those. Other questions? If there's none. Oh, sorry.
For dorsal heart anatomy, I was going to the electrocytes, and so for the diagrams, one of them showed that C fibers were responding to one lamina, and the other one, it was showing that they were responding to a different one, so I got kind of confused. So could you go over what we need to know for each lamina?
So of reason that those slides are a little bit confusing is because nobody really knows the fine circuitry of this in any detail, so everybody's slide looks a little bit different. But really, I mean, the C fiber inputs go to lambda 1, that's the peptidergic ones, okay? Lambda 2, which is the non-peptidergic or IV4 ones, okay? And then lambda 5 also has some C fiber but more A delta inputs. The A beta fibers are going to lambda 3 and lambda 4. So what, the other thing you need to remember is where the projection neurons are. So the neurons that go on up to the brain, right, the second order neurons, those are found in lambda 1 and lambda 5. Which is a little weird because remember the non-peptidergic ones all go into lambda 2. But hopefully you remember those other slides that show that the non-peptidergic neurons connect to neurons in lambda 2 that project to lambda 5, where these other projection neurons are, right? So there's an indirect pathway through which the IV4 neurons connect to projection neurons, and that's through lambda 2, and then to lambda 5, and then on up to the brain.
And that's the IV4, right?
That's the IV4, guys. But the projection neurons are found in lambda 1 and lambda 5. Okay? So again, lambda 1, peptidergic, lambda 2, non-peptidergic, lambda 3, lambda 4, A beta fibers, lambda 5, C fibers, but mostly A delta fibers, projection neurons, lambda 1, lambda 5. Any more? Okay, you guys all basically hit home runs on the first exam, so I hope you do the same on the second exam. I like to see good grades in your learning. May or may not mean that I'm teaching well.